Name, amen. So we're still talking about faithfulness and the attributes of faithfulness, the DNA of faithfulness, and we've said simply this beautiful package representing our salvation, and that faithfulness is simply what you do with salvation, what you do with what has been done for you, because ultimately what you do with what's been done for you is going to reveal what's been done for you and how it works in your life. You have to do something with it. And so when we're looking at this issue of being right, and we've talked about it for several weeks now, we've talked about being right in our body, being right at work. We want to look at today being right as it pertains to the way that we think. And it's important that we remember that being right, when we look at this, this is a commitment to progress. Because ultimately in Christ Jesus, we've already been made the righteousness of God. So this is about maturing into what we have been made and reflecting that. So that's what we're looking at when we're looking at being right. And so there's a right way and there's a wrong way to think. I want you to consider this thought today. You can write it in your notes. You have two minds. You have two minds, and you're determining every single day, moment by moment, to yield to one or the other. If you want to turn in your Bible, we'll start in Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, and we're going to look at verses 6 through 8, and we're going to be reading it in the New King James and then also the Passion Bible. So this is Romans chapter 8, verses 6 through 8. It's so important that you take this time, regardless of the realm and the place with which you're a leader. God needs us in the sense that his work would be done through us. He's in heaven, and he's given all authority and all power to his church. And so the fact that you're here or you're watching online really establishes a hunger, but it's not just what you hear, it's what you do with what you hear. And so we're believing today that you hear some things, but then it also begins to work itself into your life as you go home and you spend some time with it. Verse 6 of Romans chapter 8 in the New King James, "For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is at enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. So then those who are in the flesh cannot please God." And so we see here two minds. We see a spiritual mind and we see a carnal mind. And carnal and flesh using interchangeably. So that last verse, verse 8. So those who are in the carnal mind, those who are in the fleshly mind, they cannot please God. See, the enemy works on senses, on feelings. And so ultimately, when you find identification, or when you find place in your fleshly mind, in your carnal mind, when he can successfully get you in that territory, then he's got you defeated. So you want to keep him in your spiritual mind, so to speak. It's kind of like, you know, there would be certain teams that maybe they felt like they had a home court advantage, that when they were on their court and when they were in their hometown, they had an advantage. Well, the enemy has an advantage when you yield to your fleshly mind, when you're carnally minded. But when you choose instead to be spiritually minded, the Passion Bible reads it this way: "For the mindset of the flesh is death, but the mindset controlled by the Spirit finds life and peace. In fact, the mindset focused on the flesh fights God's plan and refuses to submit to his direction." See, I think it's important that we understand that your mind never gets saved. It's only your spirit. It's your job to do something with your mind. Yeah. And we said several weeks ago, if your mind is out of control, your life is out of control. So if we work in reverse, if your life is out of control, your mind is out of control. It has nothing to do with circumstances around you. It has nothing to do with what's been done to you, who fired you, who hired you, who divorced you. None of those things are relevant. Your mind is your mind. And if you have possession of it, then you have the opportunity to control it. And Proverbs 23:7 says, for as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. So if your mind is out of control, your life is out of control. And the reality is your mind, until the day you take your last breath, Brother Hagin said it this way, and we talked about it, that just like your hair has to be combed every day. And you can just hear him saying that. They used combs back then. I like that. Your hair has to be combed every day. Your mind has to be renewed every day. Yeah. Your hair has to be put in its place, so to speak, every single day. Your mind has to be put in its place every single day. And if we don't maintain the discipline of that, then we see right here what's gonna be produced. The mindset focused on flesh fights God's plan and refuses to submit to his direction. So if we don't renew our mind, if we don't put our mind in its place, subject to the authority of the Word of God, then we'll go in the wrong direction instead of going in the right direction with God's plan. For no matter how hard they try, God finds no pleasure with those who are controlled by the flesh. Now, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 16 says that we have the mind of Christ. So we want to operate from that place. We want to operate from his mind. John chapter 16, verse 13 gives us the access point. How do we lay hold of, obviously through our faith, but before you can release your faith for something, you have to have confident possession of it. And it's the Holy Spirit that enables us to take possession of all that God has provided for us. So if I have the mind of Christ, how do I access it? How do I yield to that? Well, John chapter 16, verse 13 says, howbeit when the Spirit of truth is come, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak of himself, but whatever he shall hear, he will speak, and he will show you things to come. So as I pray in the Holy Spirit, as I build myself up on my most holy faith, praying in tongues, then I get out of my own mind and I get into the mind of Christ. And you have to deliberately and intentionally do that. Just like for those of you that are here in the building, and even those of you that are watching, you know, online, you had to intentionally position yourself. You had to log on. You had to get in your car. You had to take some action. We have to take action with our mind. Just because we don't see it doesn't mean it's not producing in our lives. And so consider this statement if you want to write it down. If you think wrong in opposition to the word and the mind of Christ, if you think wrong, which we're defining as in opposition to the word and the mind of Christ, you cannot have a supernatural life. Now, all of these things begin to work together, but ultimately, science has helped us and obviously just proved scripture, but you're thinking, feeling, and choosing all the time. So your emotions aren't the leaders. If you feel it, you first thought it. And if you did it, you felt it and you thought it both. And we don't want to live life based on our own feelings, based on our own choosing, based on our own thoughts. What does Isaiah chapter 55 say? His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. His ways are bigger than our ways. And that's been so misspoken in religion to make it seem as though that God was this far off, unreachable, untouchable in his plan, and we never know what he's going to do. But the reality is we have been given access to everything that he wants to do. But his doing is so far superior to any of our doing. Why would we ever want to live in our doing, so to speak? And all of these things kind of go together, but I want you to write down the word harmony. I want you to think about that as it pertains to what we're able to do, what we're able to accomplish on earth while he's in heaven. You know, you've probably all experienced, and I'm not sure, is somebody back there? Yes, I couldn't see you. Let me illustrate this for you. I want you to watch this quick video of some musicians who aren't harmonizing together. Let's start there. Okay, and now those that are harmonizing together.
Deliver you.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man?
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will come to...
All right, that's good. So I want you to think about that this week, that you are literally harmonizing with the thoughts of God and the plans of God, or you're working in opposition to that. Now, nobody is going to listen, and that was a talent show, but those guys aren't going to make it. Nobody's going to buy their album because nobody's going to produce their album. And so many believers never make progress in the plans of God because they never submit their mind to him. See, Mark 12:30 says that we're to love God with all our heart, all our soul, all our mind, and all of our strength. So in essence, mind, and this is Mark 12:30, mind is listed twice. Because in your soul is your mind, your will, and emotions. But Jesus said, you love me with all your heart, all your soul, which your mind's included in that, all your mind, and all your strength. So if we don't love him with our mind, which means we willfully choose to think in line with his word. See, we've made our thoughts, we've taken them so personally, and we've crippled our own consciousness by this is how I've always thought, or this is just the way that I look at it. You know, but it's wrong. And the way that you've always thought has produced death. It's produced a life of being out of control. It's produced a life of addiction. It's produced a life of bondage. So just choose not to think like that. You choose not to. You can control your mind. You can control what you think. Now all of these things work together as it pertains to the person of the Holy Spirit, and then of course walking by love, or walking in love, because God is love. These three things go together. If I'm going to be a person of discipline, if I'm going to be a person who is mentally sound, then I cannot yield to fear, which means I cannot get out of love, and I have to respond to the direction of the Holy Spirit. But then once he has instructed me, I have to hold my ground. No matter what impulses come, no matter what stimuli I receive from external experiences, once I have it from the word, and once I've aligned myself with the love of God, I cannot be moved. I cannot allow my mind to vacillate. I cannot allow my mind to get into the realm of reason and endeavoring to figure things out. But let me tell you, the moment that you step out of love, you've opened the door to fear, and you've created chaos in your mind. You cannot make a godly decision outside of love. You cannot move forward in his plan outside of love. And you cannot move forward in his plan outside of the direction of the Spirit. So we have to take control of our mind and put it in subjection to the mind of Christ, which looks instead like being led by the Spirit and not what I think. Let me give you an illustration of this, and then we'll jump back into a couple of thoughts that we've begun over the last couple weeks. We want to look at three kinds of thoughts and determine to think correctly. But yesterday morning, I was still in bed, and I was just kind of awoken by the Spirit of God. We were going to be traveling. We had taken the interns out of town, and we were going to be traveling. And the Holy Spirit woke me up before my alarm went off, and he said, "You need to plead the blood over your connections." That was the word that just kept coming up in my heart, was connections. your connections. And so I just began, I didn't do anything super exorbitant. I mean, I'm so cozy and I have my little hand warmers. We slept with our hand warmers. We put them everywhere. So I was just so cozy and I didn't do anything super spiritual or anything. I just began to use my words and I just said, Father, right now, I just plead the blood over connections. I mean, it was such a peaceful thing that I went back to sleep and really didn't think about it again until I was in the plane. And I realized, oh, this is why the Spirit of God prompted me in this way. So we had left late from one airport and we're sitting on the runway and I'm watching them. I'm like, they've been filling this plane up with gas forever, like fuel, you know, like we got to go, you know. So they begin to tell us what time we're going to be arriving, where we would make our connection to come back home. And it's like, wow, that's going to be, you know, 13 minutes before our plane's supposed to leave. So that doesn't give us a lot of time. That's landing time. That doesn't include taxiing, getting off the plane, running from that gate to the next gate, 13 minutes. Wow, the clock is really ticking. So I'm just sitting there and you've got an hour left in flight, which in essence could potentially equate to an hour of torment. Like, what are we going to do here, right? So I'm just quieting myself, and I just said, Father, right now I just commission the angels of God to go and interrupt and delay that next flight in the name of Jesus. And so then I still have a decision to make. Am I going to sit here and let my mind be worried? Am I going to sit here and be upset and be frustrated with the company, be frustrated with the stewardess, be frustrated with everything that transpired that created these circumstances? Am I going to get out of love? Am I going to get into fear? Am I going to get into frustration? Am I going to get into anxiety? We're in the back of the plane. Am I going to stand up and punch everybody that tries to get in our way? And you know, we've got a group. There's a group of us. It's not just one. There's nine of us, right? And so we just determined we're going to hold on to love and we're going to hold on to the word and we're not going to get in anxiety. We're not going to get into fear. And so the moment that plane landed, we're standing up. Everyone's standing up. A lot of people had connections. And it's like they took forever to open the door. And we're like, get us off the plane, you know? So you still have these opportunities, right? So everything's moving really, really slow. Because again, we're in the back of the plane, even to get everybody off. Finally, the stewardess got online and on the intercom and said, listen, if you don't have a connection, get out of the aisle. I have a group of nine in the back that are really, I mean, she was a go-getter, right? But at that point, you know what I mean? We were blessed to have that. But so we get off the plane and literally we took off. I mean, we're running. We're only a few gates away. But we get there and the door's closed. And they're not going to open it. They're not going to open it. And so at that point, you know, you got to stay in love. You got to stay in love. You have to stay in love. And so they come and they say, listen, depending on whose fault this was, if this was weather. And I said, no, sir, I assure you it was not weather. They told us when we left, this was a mechanical issue. We'll put you up in a hotel. And I'm like, I can't stay, you know, I'm thinking, like, I can't stay the night here. I got to get home, right? We'll put you up in a hotel, on and on and on. So we're thinking and we're saying, okay, well, we have this option. And Pastor Greg's like, just hold the ground. You know, just hold the ground. And ultimately, eventually, they opened the gate back up. They opened the gate back up. They reissued us new boarding passes, the whole thing. But I wanted you to see the progression. You know, that a life out of control doesn't, a mind out of control doesn't pick up on these little responses, these little impulses from the Spirit that would say, do this. Because literally, when we got on that plane, there was a water issue. Okay, the angels were holding up the water, whatever the issue was. But then at a later time, they said that the plane hadn't met capacity. They didn't have enough passengers. They couldn't leave without us. Do you understand what they didn't have? So regardless, the Father took the initiative as he impulsed us, you know, by the Spirit. You know, take your authority here. Do this. This is why it's so important. You want to live a supernatural life. So many people don't. They figure it out. They plan it. They try to make it happen on their own because their mind's out of control. That's why it's so important that we stay in love. Love is patient. That's why it's never worth it to get frustrated. It's never worth it to get irritable. It's never worth it to be touchy. It's never worth it to hold on to petty offenses or grievances. And people have held on to them for years. No wonder you're so mad. No wonder things in your life are so out of control. You've allowed yourself to be bitter for decades. And that works in opposition. That does not harmonize with the mind of Christ. See, it's our job to get into harmony with him. It's not his job to get into harmony with us. It's our job to get in harmony with him, which means we've got to yield. That means what happens when you yield? You defer to somebody else. So we're deferring. We're saying, I don't have to figure it out. I don't have to have all the answers. It doesn't have to be my way, but I'm deferring. I'm putting on the brakes and I'm saying, Father, instead, I want to hear from you. You know, there's a couple of you, and let's just bow our heads and close our eyes. Father God, we love you right now. We trust you. We trust you, Father God. There's been situations, some in this room, even right now, some, they're small situations, but yet you've tried to figure it out. You've tried to make it happen on your own. And then there was another bigger answer. And the Spirit of God would say to you today, rest in me by first taking your place of authority. I've seated you in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. You're seated above this circumstance. You're seated above this problem. You did all you knew to do. You were not slothful. You did all you knew to do. So now take your place of authority. Stay in love. I will give you the words to say as you begin to partner with me. You'll use the authority of my name in such a way that things will change. Things will change. The answers are here. The answers are here. We thank you, Father God, that we have the mind of Christ. We thank you, Father God, for answers. Father, we receive grace and forgiveness and help where we had jumped out and tried to make it happen on our own. We thank you, Father God. We yield instead to your mind. We thank you that the answers are here. See, that's what's so important. Romans chapter 5, you can't get in his mind without getting in a place or taking your place of victory. So it's already, it's always a perspective of victory. The enemy always wants to get you defeated. Right. What are you going to do now? What are you going to do now? What are you going to do now? No, I'm already victorious. Yeah. And I'm going to have the answers. I'm going to have the supply to move into that victory, to grow up into that victory. In Romans chapter 5, verse 8, God demonstrates his own love towards us, that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. How much more then, having been justified by his blood, shall we be saved from wrath through him? For if then we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son. Much more now, having been reconciled, shall we be saved. And then in this same chapter, let me go, Romans 5, jumping down to verse 17, says we'll reign in life. Yes. So we'll not only be saved by his life, but we'll reign in life. And so for by one man's offense, death reigned, much more they which receive an abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life. So remember, and we'll write these three things down and we'll get into them more next week. Number one, we can't yield to any accusing thoughts. We have to take our place of victory. The enemy is constantly accusing the brethren, Revelation chapter 12, verse 10. He's constantly trying to make you feel like you're not going to make it and it's not going to work and you're not going to have what it takes and you're not going to have enough and you're not going to get healed. Remember when the enemy kept trying to tell Brother Hagin that he had been healed from an incurable heart disease and some symptoms came back and the enemy said, that's it, this time you're not going to get healed. And Brother Hagin just started laughing at him. He just kept laughing at him. He said, what are you laughing at? And he said, I'm laughing at you. And the enemy's like, why are you laughing at me? You're the one that's not going to get healed. And he said, I'm already healed. I'm already healed. See, the place, the foundation for being spiritually minded is a perspective of victory. A perspective of victory. You can't allow the enemy to bring shame into your life and accusing thoughts. And remember, we said what the enemy endeavors to do is he endeavors to take correction that you're given and turn it into condemnation. But the reality is you have to be corrected or you will never grow up into your victory. Just because somebody is 5 years old and they've been endowed, you know, an inheritance or a vehicle doesn't mean that they're ready for the keys as a 5 year old. But they've still got a car. It still belongs to them. Just because they've been trusted, you know, millions of dollars doesn't mean as a 7 year old that they're financially responsible enough to steward all that. But that's still theirs. But they've got to grow up into that. That's why Hebrews chapter 12, verse 6 says, for the Lord's training of your life is the evidence of his faithful love. When he draws you to himself, it proves you are his delightful child. Fully embrace God's correction. Why? So that you can grow up into the victory. Yeah. The enemy's such a liar. Every time you're getting corrected, whether it's through the avenue of preaching or in a setting at work or whatever, that's God's gift to you to continue to grow you up and to move you farther into his plan. And the enemy will try to shame you, or he'll get you out of love and offended with the very people who he's using to bring the correction into your life so that you can grow up into the victory. He's such a liar. He will take something that's so good and turn it into what you would perceive to be wrong. Yeah. But yet you're never going to grow up into your victory without truth, without the truth spoken in love. This is the purpose for our ministry gifts. This is the purpose for our assembly. This is why we don't get weary in well-doing. This is why we don't stop coming to church, stop hearing the word, because we want to grow up into our victory. It's already ours. We've already taken possession of it when we made Jesus the Lord of our life. But if we really are mature in it, then why aren't we exercising it? Why aren't we moving into it? Because we're immature. Because we've not been corrected. Because we've not been disciplined, or we've not heeded the instruction. So you've already got it, but you grow up into it by truth, by correction. So you have to think correctly. The enemy can take your mistake and make it more potent than the blood. So don't do that. Don't drag what you did yesterday into today. Forgive and forget. You can't do anything about it. And if you can, the Spirit of God will show you what to do to make it right, to go and receive forgiveness, to extend an apology. But don't allow yourself to be defeated every time you make a mistake. The more disciplined you'll be mentally, the fewer mistakes you'll make. But when you do make them, just be quick to repent. Be quick to apologize. Be quick to make it right. The enemy can take the wrongs of others and blame them on you. Make it your fault. And really, the only reason why he could successfully get away with that is when you'll allow your own choices and decisions to be the fault of other people. Well, if my dad hadn't done this, and if this person hadn't done that, and if I had been raised this way, if I'd been raised like you had been raised, then I would be better off. No, no, no. You make your choices based on you making your choices. And if you don't like those choices, then you've got to educate yourself. You've got to train yourself, word and spirit, or if it's professionally, you've got to do something different in order to choose different. But it's nobody, the life that you have right now is the life that you've chosen. It's nobody else's fault, which is why the people around you, the choices that they make, they made those choices. It wasn't your fault that they did what they did. The enemy would love to make you the problem, because if he can convince you mentally that you're the problem, that he's got you, then he's got you on this little hamster wheel constantly trying to get there. No, Jesus already got us there. But in correction and in discipline and in maturity, I align myself with the victory that has been provided. And by faith through love, I can access it. I can lay hold of it. I can bring it into manifestation. So, Father, help us this week.